Welcome back to Off-Grid News, our take on the on-grid world. And in today's show, we talk about why the bankers should pay back their bonuses to the banks they work for. In the opening scenes of Wall Street 2, Gordon Gekko leaves jail after serving a fraud sentence. That has yet to happen in real life. While millions of families watch their homes and savings go up in smoke, the bankers, hedgies, insurers, and other financial managers are hanging on both to their jobs and their wine cellars, their yachts, the art collections, and the other trophies they bought with their vast bonuses accumulated over the past decade. Bonuses paid on falsely declared profits. Why these financiers have not been lined up and interrogated about each and every deal that led to the global financial meltdown is a question only history will answer. The IMF estimates the total value of all write-downs by banks and other financial institutions at roughly $3.4 trillion. And that came after a decade of profits, which have since turned out to be largely illusory. It's a fair assumption that the value of the write-down is equal to the value of the falsely declared profits. And the bankers were paid bonuses on the basis of those profits. Bonus pools in the financial industry, by the way, tend to be about 30% of profits. So do the math. That is $1.1 trillion that could help bail out the banks, pension funds, and other financial businesses. Western countries, coincidentally, have spent about $1 trillion on the bailout. And there is one big, fat, unanswered question at the heart of this scandal. Why should the financiers hold on to those bonuses? Why is there no call for them to repay the money, not to us, but to the companies they work for? Every financial company that is now issuing the write-downs has detailed the size of its bonus pool. And that money could be recovered from the individual recipients on the grounds that it was based on falsely declared profits, assets which were inflated in value to the point where actual dishonesty took place, such as at Lehman's, or in some cases, the profits just never existed at all, such as John Thain's decision to pay Merrill Lynch bonuses a month early, just ahead of the BofA takeover. It is a fact that Lehman Brothers were warned by their auditors and accountants that they were overstating their profits the year before they went bust. The board, however, decided to ignore this advice and declared the profits they did. As a result, they got larger bonuses. At the time, many in the financial world were openly boasting about the overinflation of the price of derivatives and CDOs, which they were conniving with. But the auditors all somehow missed this. The big accountancy firms and auditors like Grant Thornton, Ernst & Young, KPMG, PwC and Deloitte were a key part of the scam because they sanctioned the accountants' reports, for which they were paid highly and for which their executives should now be arrested and charged. All the auditors' assets could be seized and used to finance the huge number of lawsuits that will be brought by disgruntled bankers if they are forced to pay back the bonuses. But meanwhile, the financial industry would receive the boost to its liquidity that it needs and that we, all of us, need it to have. If directors award themselves a bonus from a company, and then the company finds retrospectively that the directors behaved in a dishonest way, the company can go after the directors and ask for the bonuses back. Plus, it's a criminal offence, at least in the UK, called breach of fiduciary duty. UBS, which is based in Switzerland and is specifically looking into this, and UK and US banks and finance houses could do the same. And when they retrieve the money, they could either use it to repay some of the taxpayer aid they have since squandered, or preferably lend it to high-risk, small businesses on generous terms. That has been another issue of Off-Grid News. Thanks for watching and see you again soon.